She'll just do anything to get out of being there.
Good morning and welcome to today's school board meeting. Now would be the appropriate time to check your cell phone and electronic devices. And let me remind you that our requirements are that if you're in this room or in our facility, that you must wear face covering and a mask. Our vision statement is that all students achieve success in college, career, and life. And our thought for the day is by Colleen Bowman.
And I got lucky. I got the thought for the day for Teacher Appreciation Week, the same as last year, I believe. So during Teacher Appreciation Week, it's only appropriate that we acknowledge our outstanding Pasco County teachers. So Pasco teachers, it's May. You're in the home stretch. Thank you for showing up for our students or for being there for them in so many ways. Thank you for learning new technologies. Thank you for helping students catch up after they've been quarantined. Thank you for balancing face-to-face instruction with e-learning. Thank you for attending virtual IEP meetings and professional development workshops. Thank you for adapting to changing circumstances and being resilient. Thank you for your efforts to keep our children safe. Thank you for being flexible and finding new ways to connect with students and with each other. Thank you for being role models, advocates, coaches, directors, club sponsors, mentors, and counselors. Thank you for seeing the potential in all of our students. Thank you for responding to countless emails from concerned parents and guardians. Thank you for the time you spend giving students meaningful feedback on their work. Thank you for cheering them on and celebrating their accomplishments. Thank you for the life lessons you teach day in and out. Thank you for instilling a love of learning. Thank you for having high expectations and helping students achieve them. Thank you for inspiring students with your enthusiasm for your content. You don't just teach in Pasco schools. You don't just work in Pasco County schools. You are Pasco County schools. You are the heart and soul of our schools. You are what makes our district great. In a year that has been anything but ordinary, you have not been ordinary. You have been extraordinary. Thank you for your dedication, professionalism, and passion during Teacher Appreciation Week and always.
Thank you. If you would stand for the pledge, please. Let the record reflect that all board members are present, along with our superintendent attorney, other than Ms. Crumley. Ms. Crumley was on her way here and was rear-ended in a car accident. She is okay, but is at the scene and not able to be with us so far. We would ask today during our moment of silence that you remember the families of two that we have lost: Kalina Lounsbury, a fourth grade teacher, Jim Jennings, a driver in transportation services, and I know unnamed that we have a couple of other teachers that are in serious health consequences today, health situations today, that we would ask that you remember those two in our moment of silence. Thank you. Board members, last week we provided the minutes of the regular meeting and the workshop from April 20th. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Armstrong, second by Bowdoin. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. We have a public hearing today on the student code of conduct, and I'll turn it over to our attorney.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ladies and gentlemen, this is to announce the public comment portion of the student code of conduct for 21-22 public hearing. This notice of hearing has been posted on the district website and in publications in compliance with Florida statutes. Any member of the public who wishes to be heard on the Student Code of Conduct 21-22 should have already completed a speaker request form that you can receive at the entrance to the boardroom or from the board secretary. When called, please approach the podium, state your name and address for the record. Each speaker will have 3 minutes to speak unless an extension is granted by the board chair. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a public hearing, so if there is anyone who's present that wants to be heard on this issue, now is the time to come forward. Mr. Chair, let the record reflect that no one approaches the podium.
Mr. Chairman, can I speak?
Yes.
Thank you. I did notice some changes that were made since the workshop about jeans with rips, tears, and holes in them. So I reviewed the policy again. Parents of girls have expressed concern about the dress code and how it appears to target girls, and that girls are being body shamed. It should be long enough to cover the legs to 4 inches above the knee. So those are my suggestions, if anybody has any comments.
Send it back to staff for review. I mean, it went through the process to get here.
Yeah, I know, but then they made a change, so I looked at it again.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, the change was made before it went to public hearing. So that's the difference. I think that if we do that, I think we would probably need to come back to re-advertise with another public hearing in the future. What we can do is we can, my suggestion might be, is to adopt the current student code of conduct that's before you. And then what we can do is, in the interim, we can make changes and either bring those back or bring
maybe
them back for next year.
Maybe do an amendment or something? But is anybody else agree, though?
Yeah.
Because I don't want you to go through that if it's just me, but do other people think that?
I've received some emails on that as well.
It's not, even on the change that came up since the last workshop, it's not as easy as saying that the shirt needs to cover from armpit to armpit and straps need to be an inch wide, because I will assure you there is going to be something out there that's not going to fall into that. One of the challenges we have is that it's not applied uniformly from campus to campus, from school to school, and we're working on that.
You can wordsmith, but it is, I mean, these are really applying to girls.
And I would agree with you.
Blouses, bikini tops.
I would agree with you. And we, what I'd like to do is, I'm not sure we can get an amendment back to this board before school starts, because I think it's more complex than just looking at the things that you've mentioned. My recommendation would be is to adopt the dress code or the student code of conduct as it is today, and then let us really do a deep dive on not only that, but there's either other sections of that student code of conduct that I think we need to address.
Well, we're not voting today, right?
No.
No, it's a, no.
Yeah. It just restarts the clock.
Right. So it would be
and I'm not
two
sure.
Weeks.
Well, not necessarily, because there's, if you're going through 120, there's processes in place where you've got to advertise, and if someone requests a public hearing, which we would do a public hearing, but, and I don't know why I'm saying this, you're the attorney.
I apologize for not bringing it up sooner, but people have reached out since then.
I agree, but I think that some of those issues that you raise, which are very valid, I think they can be interimly addressed through our high school principals, not just our high school principals, but all of our principals in the interim. But I do think that in the interim, we need to do probably a deeper dive on the dress code piece of that particular policy.
And I will tell you, from having gone through this multiple times in the past, that it is much more difficult than what it would seem. And this has been addressed multiple times in multiple ways and continues to be a point of contention, no matter what it seems like we do. So,
yeah, and I realize, I mean, dress code is and I hate that we spend so much time even addressing this in schools, because it's taking kids out of class, you know, and it's sucking up our administrators' time. I get it. But I do think we need to move, you know, into this, forward with this. Other districts I looked around have taken out some of that. So even if we adjusted a little bit to take out those references, anyway, that's my two cents. We're not voting tonight. So.
Mr. Chair, if I can just very briefly respond. I agree with the superintendent. So, you know, the rulemaking exercise is one that you can make small, non-significantly substantive changes to things between initial publication, because that's the whole point of the process. Mm-hmm. But under the circumstances, there could be an argument as to whether or not that's substantive or not. So it's probably better to, and I support the idea of adopting it as it is, and then perhaps either when you make the change, and that's the reason I wanted to talk, is to just probably put some language, we'll consider some language within the code that says that the superintendent or staff may issue guidance to help with this, because there's a lot of wiggle room within the parameters. You can't specify a whole lot of things, and that would at least help. So if we put at least a more broad catch-all provision in there saying other issues can be provided by additional guidance, so it doesn't have to come to the board for formal rulemaking to split hairs about whether the strap has to be a certain width or length or thing. It'll give some discretion and authority.
Yeah, it's just listing out those things that I said definitely targeting girls.
Okay, so what pages are you
16,
looking?
16, I think it was 16.
Okay, because I'm looking at 18, and it does say exactly what you says.
Yeah, then there's two boxes.
All right.
It looks like this.
Oh, okay, it's in the second box.
Yes, it's the second box.
All right, when it talks about muscle shirts, tank tops, which would apply to both male and female.
Yeah, but see where it says strapless tops, skirts, blouses, okay. Dresses,
all right,
bikini top.
All right, so if you look at the other box, it talks about ones that dip below the
right, armpit. Right, it does say that.
All right, but it doesn't talk about the size of the straps. So
it does in the first box. But either way, I'm just saying, just leave it at that, where they have that, where it says must be at least 1 inch across.
But that wouldn't eliminate shoestring straps.
Yeah, it would. Yeah, it's 1 inch bigger than a spaghetti strap.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, so.
It's the straplet, skirts, blouses, bikini tops. I mean, they're covered by those other things.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If you tip bikini tops or spaghetti straps, must be at least 1 inch. Okay. If you just said straps. So, I mean, why do you even need bikini tops or spaghetti straps?
Right. I agree.
How would that be a substantive change since it's redundant?
And the same thing where it says blouses, because it's not changing the policy, but it's removing all those things that are targeting, you know, look like they're targeting girls.
So let me make a suggestion, because I can tell this is going to take longer than what we want, and I can also tell you that we have beat this around extensively for at least the last 14 and a half years that I'm aware of, and probably 14 before that, and there's reasoning, and so I would suggest that we get with staff that put this together and to work through that.
Yeah, because it might be considered substantive, it might not. But muscle shorts are male, you know, so I would say it goes both ways, but some of it might be considered redundant.
Okay.
That's the only thing I would say.
One very quick point. So looking at the specific language in that specific context, that whole paragraph talks about may or does. So it almost seems as though those are simply examples to help guide the discussion more than anything else.
Yeah.
So they're not rigid about that. So that's just an observation
right,
I make as we go. They're really kind of examples such as a muscle shirt
but all
or tank top.
Most of the examples are against girls is what I'm saying. It's
mostly targeting
girls.
And Mr. Chairman, if I may, final statement on this is that I agree wholeheartedly with you that when you look at that dress code, it does. But the other thing too that, and this is a prime example, is that the code, I can't believe we'll say this, being the conservative guy that I am. No, it's not. It's just that we've got to ensure that our dress code keeps up with the times.
Right.
And I will tell you that I don't have personally a problem with our female students wearing jeans with holes in them. I don't. And this is how this all came up, because then what's happening is we're putting our principals in a position of almost being the whole police.
I know.
Of having to measure jeans and stuff. And we had a great deal of conversation. I had a lot of conversation with staff about ensuring that it doesn't expose anything that's inappropriate.
Male or female.
Right.
Male
right.
or female. Right. Male or female.
Right.
So I just think that we probably, that's why I keep going back is going and saying that we probably need to do a deeper dive not only on this section, but really do a thorough deep dive on this policy to ensure that it's relevant, that it's not putting our principals, much less our students and teachers, in a position where they've got to police things like every day, every hour. I know of an instance where there were girls being sent home to change and boys were being sent to class. That's inappropriate. If you're going to send girls home to change, you need to be sending boys home to change. But that's kind of not...
And we're sending kids home when we want them.
Right, but that's not in the purview necessarily of the dress code. It was the communication or the training we have with our principals.
Okay.
So okay with...
Well, we're not.
Yeah, we're not voting today, but leaving it scheduled as we have now and moving ahead with...
I'm not okay with leaving strapless tops, skirts, blouses, bikini tops. If you want to take those out.
All right, but I mean, right now we're having the public hearing.
Why don't we just say tops?
With the measurement or whatever.
You know, why don't we just say tops, you know?
I think right now we're having the public hearing, and this discussion would really come at the next board meeting, wouldn't it? When we get ready to vote.
They would not have an opportunity to comment on this at the next board meeting as 120 goes, because this is the public hearing for this policy. That's why I'm saying, and the attorney can correct me, it would really restart the clock, because then we have to go back in, advertise the changes, and then go back into another public hearing. What I need to do is I need to get with Dennis, Mr. Alfonso, to ensure that we have time to reconvene the Student Code of Conduct Committee, really, and I don't mean just very quickly rush through it so we can get it back to the board, but if we're going to make changes and we're going to get it postured in a way that really is meaningful or meaningful changes, and then still have time to advertise, have the public hearing, and bring it back to a final vote. I will tell you, it needs to be in place before school starts in August.
Right. Well, it's got to be able to be printed, too, so.
It's got to be in place by August.
I think maybe removing it, just removing those examples who might not be considered substantive, that's something that would need to be considered when you all met.
So Dennis, maybe you can, Attorney Alfonso,
I mean, that's something maybe you could weigh in before the next school board meeting.
So, all right. If the consensus of, you're not taking action at this point in time.
Right.
So it'd almost be like, well, if the board wants to direct that through consensus and directive that there's a change, I won't be horribly offended about any potential violation of Chapter 120, because what will happen is the record of this meeting is there. There is public comment before you would adopt this item on the agenda at the next board meeting. And then we could sit and suffer through whether it's substantive or not substantive, if it ever comes up as an issue. Again, looking at it in the context, it's really, you're not changing materially what is or isn't.
Well,
you're just giving
the
examples.
Whole point, you know, of having the public hearing is if the public expressed these concerns that we would address it.
Right, right. So I guess my point is that if the board wants to change it, better, you have two options. Direct it by majority a change now, so that it's part of these minutes, it's part of the amendment that goes to final adoption next meeting and we're done. Or adopt, don't say anything, adopt what happens next week and then request or direct that an amendment comes out through the public, you know, process, through the Chapter 120 process.
So do we have to have a motion, or can we just see if we agree to take out those words?
I think at this point, I don't want to make this more... You know, if the majority of the board feels strongly to make this change, then there should be a vote on this now to direct the modification or amendment now, so that it can be published and it'd be part of the agenda, that's the item that's actually approved by the board at the next board meeting.
All right.
Okay, so then I move that we remove the things that strapless tops, bikini tops, blouses, backless shirts, dresses that all seem to... we can just make it simpler and say tops.
Can I make a suggestion, if I may, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Bowen, is if you make your motion overly broad, that allows us to go in and make whatever, because I think when you start getting down into sizes of straps and armpit,
I wasn't saying that part. I was saying removing those words. But
I mean,
removing the words that seem to be... applying.
I think if you make a motion that provides the intent, I know exactly what your intent is, but then it gives staff a little more latitude to come back in and not just look at straps and it might be ball caps.
Okay, so I move that we revisit this to adjust it in a way that it doesn't appear to be targeting typical girl clothing.
Second?
Motion, second, just discussion, if any.
Okay, so motion by Bogan, second by Harding, discussion.
Yeah, I would go so far as to say that the, as much as possible, the...
Be gender neutral?
Be gender neutral.
Yeah, let's do that.
I don't think you need to say...
Girl, oh yeah, no, I agree with you.
Because you don't want to target male either.
Right.
I think it needs to, I would...
Yeah, let's do that.
Do the amendment.
So if you would amend the motion, amend the second...
I'll amend my motion to say I move that we, why don't we just, can I stop that one and start?
You could withdraw the motion, withdraw the second.
Withdraw the motion, and I'll move that we, that staff look at this again and rewrite it in a way that's gender neutral.
Second.
So you have a motion and a second on the revised motion. Any discussion?
Thank you, Mrs. Armstrong.
Yeah, thank you, Ms. Armstrong.
So let me just say, based on having done this before, that my preference would be that we involve staff, they're the ones that are in the schools dealing with it, and the committee that determined why they use these examples, because there are some specific cases that have caused this. And so if we're going to do that motion and move forward, then I'm going to request that those that are engaged in the implementation of the rules be involved again, as they were before, in the process of determining to make sure that it fits what we need to have appropriate dress in our schools.
Understood.
Okay.
All right. Everybody okay with that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. All in favor, signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. All right. I have no green cards, and we have no special presentations today, so we move on to United School Employees. Mr. Peace.
Superintendent Browning, Attorney Alfonso, Chair Altman, honorable board members and district staff, I hope you are all doing well. I just have one bit of news today, as everything else pales in comparison. It is with great sadness that USCP announces the passing last night of one of our members, Jim Jennings, a bus driver from a Northwest compound. Jim was employed since 2012 and a member of our organization since 2016. Jim served USCP in many capacities, organizer, building rep, and executive board, but most importantly as a friend. As we get details of services, we will share them for those who wish to attend. But I would ask today that you please pray for his wife and their family as they go through this time of loss.
Thank you, Mr. Peace. Board member committee reports. Ms. Harding.
I had none.
Ms. Bodwin.
I had none.
All right. I had a school health advisory committee, which isn't technically a committee that I'm supposed to cover, but it was always tagged on to the student wellness committee that I covered. And there's so many grants and so on, and emphasis on mental health, student mental health, that go through this committee. I just would like to give a brief report on it. One thing as far as health ed update. The growth and development curriculum is ready to be implemented. The training has been done. We are using a grant to make some of our own curriculum videos, so we're not having to rely on someone else's. We can do something that matches exactly what we feel is correct for our students. We've just finished the youth risk behavior survey, and because of a CDC grant, we were able to extend that down into the middle school and do more extensive with the high school. So we should be getting those results before too long. We also have the grant Overdose to Action. There is a lot going on with that. That's preventing opioids from being in our schools, preventing deaths of students by opioids. So it's a very active grant, and we hope to save lives of students. The Crisis Intervention Team went out on 19 calls this past year so far under mental health. We have the youth at risk. We've had 6 cases that were staffed in March and 11 cases that were staffed this year. One really I thought was just very interesting data. It had to do with the threat to self. We did 444 assessments in the first semester. The largest number of assessments are in the elementary schools. We had 59 Baker Act transports as a result of those assessments, and the largest number of those are in the high schools. So that is a lot of work that went into assessing our students to make sure that they would not be a threat to themselves or commit suicide. The other, student mental health, the training goes on for that. All staff is being trained in student mental health. We have, I think, up to getting more and more trainers trained for that. And also, along with those lines, Wesley Chapel High School is working hard to become a certified school for suicide prevention. So if that works out well, that would probably be a program that would be expanded to other high schools. So a lot is going on with our students' health and mental health. So I just wanted you to be aware of all the work that is being done by stellar committee members, stellar staff, just working hard to keep our students safe.
So last Thursday, I attended on behalf of our board the Preferred Insurance Trust Fund State Board meeting that I serve on. Fortunately, our team made the decision, and this board approved last year doing a 2-year plan for most of our coverages. So we are somewhat, at least in the short term, protected. But I can tell you that as you probably read in every paper every day for the past little bit, the property market in the state of Florida is in utter chaos because of fraud and greed. And for those of you that may not have read, 8% of the homeowners' claims filed in the United States in 2019 were from Florida, and 76% of all the lawsuits filed on property claims in the United States were from Florida alone. So that is impacting the market even for municipalities and school boards and the rest of it. And rate increases in the range of 15% on most of the coverages. Again, we are somewhat protected on that now, but probably should be prepared for significant increases next year when they come and make appropriate planning. I will tell you, if you recall, we have towers of reinsurance and $100 million and $140 million. One of the things that I watch is where we are on the modeling for storms. And so just so you know, what we call our school tower of reinsurance right now is $240 million of coverage. And based on the latest modeling of all of the other 6 districts that we participate with, in a 100-year storm, it looks like about $99 million in potential losses. In a 250-year storm, $154 million. That's what we model. So right now, it appears that the reinsurance towers that we have for the school districts and the municipalities that we partner with to share our risks, that we are adequately insured for almost up to a 500-year storm. So I feel good about that. I will tell you that as a part of that insurance trust the surplus money is invested, and so we get a really comprehensive financial report. And one of the things that the financial analyst told board members the other day for their, I'm the only school board rep, the rest of them are cities and counties and the rest of them. Anyway, they told them to make sure that they prepared for inflation in their expense side, because all of their trends and their modeling is showing that. That was confirmed Saturday, I think, by Warren Buffett in his annual meeting, where he said they were seeing inflation in every area. So they provided us a trend line that's moving upwards, and warned all public entities to be prepared for that in their budgeting process. So that was my report on insurance. Mr. Browning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. As we celebrate Teacher Appreciation Week, this is Teacher Appreciation Day. And I will tell you, I can't thank our teachers enough for what they've done over the last school year and the last quarter of last year. They have certainly risen to the occasion and ensured that each of our students had every opportunity to be successful. Pasco School District is incredibly fortunate to have the teaching staff that we have. They work tirelessly, night and day, weekends, some virtually, some in bricks and mortar classrooms, other doing both, to make sure that their students are getting what they need. So when you get a chance, you need to thank a teacher. And Teacher Appreciation Day is every day, just not one day. I do have a request for an off-agenda item. The item would become item 15-5. This is an amendment to the current School Resource Officer School Safety Program Agreement. This addresses our data sharing protocols between the two agencies. Finally, I've asked Mike Napier, the director of the Pasco County Health Department, to be here this morning. And I'm going to ask Mr. Napier, the chairman's approval, to come to the podium and kind of update our board on where we are with COVID-19.
Good morning. Thank you, Superintendent, Chair, board members. Thanks for having me here. And it's more promising news than the last time I was here. First, I want to start by thanking Superintendent Browning and Ray Gadd, who have been instrumental in Pasco County's outcomes. It started from when we were testing children and wanting to make sure that we had the ability to test children, but also contact tracing and be able to make sure that, while at times unpopular to be able to exclude children, I think it was in the best interest of everyone involved. I also want to commend the superintendent and Ray for the vaccination of your staff and faculty here. Speaking to the region and to the state, your school superintendent took a very proactive approach to making sure that your faculty here were vaccinated. We were fortunate enough to have vaccine to be able to provide it to those individuals. And I would tell you that it was probably a best practice for the state to be able to, the way that was managed and the way that was curated, to make sure everybody was able to get vaccinated. Another thing that I want to mention is that the Department of Health worked very hard here in Pasco County to make sure that we had over 130 locations and to be able to get people vaccinated early on. We have way more requests than we had vaccine, and that was a sticking point on being able to make sure people had vaccine and how to get it and waiting in line. We worked tremendously hard to make sure that just about every pharmacy and provider was able to have vaccine if they wanted it, so people had the option to get vaccinated. I will tell you, over the last couple of weeks, the vaccine demand has been decreased, and people have a couple of reasons. They have 130 locations to get their vaccine. And also, we're vaccinating a lot of people, and that's what the report that I'm presenting to you here today. You know, where Governor pointed out that he was vaccinating 65 and older, which was a little different take than maybe other states took. However, you can see now in our 65 and older, on our report here, 74 to 76, 77% of those of that age group have been vaccinated with at least one vaccination. Those rates are all there. The reason why I wanted to show you this is that as we have our vaccination rate almost to a saturation point for our 65 and older group, now we're looking at those that are 16 and older, where we're able to vaccinate those. And if you look at the far right column, the 15 to 19 year old, that's a 13% increase in vaccinations from the week before. So it is working. We are having our children, that age group, and I guess maybe not children at 19, but our children are getting vaccinated. There is word from Pfizer that they will expect in the next coming week or so that they'll move that age group down to 12. So there will be opportunities to be vaccinated there. But our target audience is really at that lower age group, and you can see that we are making great strides in getting them vaccinated. The bottom graph describes, we had set a goal for 60%. We have done and looked at national surveys and looked at, unfortunately, only about 60% of the population actually wants the vaccine. So we set a target of 60%. Based on our current trends, we believe we will have hit that 60% overall from those that are eligible, including the seniors, at 60% by the 1st of June. On the back side is a graph that you're probably familiar with, and that's really over the course of the pandemic, where we've had spikes and where we've had certain occasions, events. Spring break was a tough time for us, as you can see towards the end of that first graph, where we did have an increase in cases, but I'm very happy to say that we're trending down again. And our positivity rate, if you look at the bottom graph, our 7-day positivity rate's about 7%, and we're averaging 117 cases a day. We are seeing an increase. Nearly a third of our cases are in that population, 0 to 24 years old. Yeah, 0 to 24 year olds. And speaking with our school staff here, a third of those cases are in that age group. And what we're finding is that when we call and either we get a test result, we get it from the school, and we find that Johnny in fourth grade is positive, and we call and talk to the mom or dad, and they say, well, yeah, my sixth grader, my ninth grader is also not feeling well. Based on those clinical conditions, they're considered positive cases, and that's why we're starting to see some higher numbers, not because they've gone out and been tested, but within that family household. I believe the last time I was here and talking to you all, we talked about a lot of the cases were within that family household. We're starting to see that again, that within that family unit. We're not seeing a lot of spread within the classrooms, but we are seeing after-school events where the kids go in the neighborhood and play, and so there's that less separation that the school rules are following, but after-school events, maybe not so much. So I think we're headed in the right direction. I think it's important that we look at June 1st and being able to say we hit that target from a vaccination standpoint. And I'm one to be, we're proud of our teachers, I'm proud of our public health system and the community that came around this. It wasn't just the health department. We couldn't have done it without the school system, without county government, and a lot of our public-private hospitals that had worked with us to make sure that vaccine was available and testing was available. So I'm here to answer any questions you may have.
Well, I have one comment, one question. I didn't say this, but this is the positivity report from our preferred trust fund meeting the other day for the workers' comp. They don't do Pasco County School District's workers' comp, so this is no reflection on us. But it almost exactly mirrors your graph.
Sure.
And this is around the state from various municipalities. My second question is that we unfortunately talked about a death today in my side of the county, East Pasco. I've had three clients in their early 50s that all ended up in ICU. We had one pass away the other day. We have another one, 50-year-old, healthy on a ventilator today. Is there indication in any of your stuff that the variants or whatever are affecting younger ages more so? Because it seems, at least, that many of these in their early 50s, late 40s, early 50s, have had issues in the past 3 or 4 weeks that initially at the beginning we didn't, at least I didn't see.
Sure. We do track the variants and how many variants are being tested and screened out. I can't answer specifically to those that are most severely, the 50-year-old example, of whether they had the variant or not. But I do know that that as far as Pasco in general, our variant population is no greater than the surrounding areas. So we're not seeing any spike in Pasco County that might say, oh, well, we've got, you know, somebody passing the variant around in a community. We track that very closely. If somebody has a variant, we contact trace around that circle of contacts to see if we have any additional exposures. There's nothing that has come to our attention that says, hey, we've got a problem in a particular east-west side or even in a particular congregate area, whether that's a school or nursing home or other locations. We track that very closely. There isn't to say that it isn't. I'm just saying that at this point, we don't have any data to be able to substantiate that.
Okay. Board members, any other questions?
Are we going to have any more clinics, like, especially once they start, like, expanding and allowing, you know, younger age? That way we can get our kids in, the parents that choose, and we can get back to normal?
Right now, Mr. Chairman, if I may, we have one more clinic scheduled on May 15th, and that is the second dose Moderna. That was supposed to be our J&J clinic, and then they put the hold on the J&J vaccine, so the county health department was very quick in responding to that with our staff, and we changed that to Moderna, which required us to have a second dose. That's May 15th. We don't have any more clinics scheduled for Pasco County employees or students. I did have a conversation with Mr. Napier about if we had the availability of the Pfizer vaccine, which has been approved for 16 and older, I believe, that we would set up a clinic for our students, or clinics for our students, if we had access to Pfizer. That's still questionable, and Mr. Napier might be able to answer that better than I.
Yeah, and the reason why Pfizer has a little, Pasco County, the health department has not received any Pfizer vaccine. It's all been Moderna. And part of that reason is the cooling requirements for Pfizer has ultra cold storage, and we didn't have a lot of that in our counties, so they gave us the Moderna. In Pasco, Pinellas County, they got a lot of Pfizer. But with this pending announcement or approval, if that does come to fruition, and I'm not here to say that it is, it's just up there for review, that Pfizer will become a commodity. It's kind of a shortage to start with until we get some of that into our county. But what we're hoping is that we're talking with our pediatric community to ensure that you should take your kid to your doctor and let them do the vaccinations. Drive-thrus are not going to work. We're not going to schedule drive-thru for kids. It's hard enough to get a kid to hold still for a vaccine in a doctor's office, much less in a car seat or somewhere where we're going to. So we need the medical community to step up and be able to provide that vaccination. School superintendent mentioned about doing a clinic here. That's the environment where we want to be able to have a little more controlled environment, where mom and dad, someone, a parent has to come with a child as well. And so we're looking at those options right now. We just haven't gotten, one, the approval, and secondly, the allocation for the vaccine. And once we do that, I think the school is a great place and a great partner to make that happen.
Yeah. I have noticed that it seems like every store I go into is advertising COVID shots of vaccines available here. So it does look like the retail side of it is really picking up as far as offering more sites.
Sure. My biggest accomplishment, I drive work every day on Ridge Road, and there's a pharmacy that has big signs out, free vaccines come in today. And that was from being screamed at because they couldn't get their vaccine, to now anybody who really wants it can come in and get it.
I appreciate that. I just want to make sure that we can offer it as much as possible. That way we can get we can have a normal school year.
Mr. Chairman, before we close, and I just want to publicly thank Mr. Napier. The relationship that we have with the County Health Department, I've said this on a number of occasions, is really, and I go back to what Mike has said earlier, it was almost like a best practice in this state, but from even the testing sites, even to the vaccination clinics, because you have some districts that just weren't offering that level of service to their staff and retirees. We included a number of our retirees into the vaccination plan as well. So thank you, yes. And thank you to your
thank
team
you.
For what
thank
came
you.
Up.
Thank you so
here.
Much.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Mr. Gadd.
I also wanted to point out, it hasn't been mentioned, that we'll be closing down our testing sites on May 28th. That's a Friday. There are three of them, as you know, Gulf Middle here and Pasco Elementary. Those will be closed as of May 28th.
Okay. Superintendent, anything else on your end?
That's it. Thank you so
Gadd.
Much.
Anything else?
I'm all good. Thank you.
Mr. Chibley.
Just two things very quickly. There is an addendum to item 10.1 in the board packet that has been uploaded for your approval. In addition, I did want to let the board know that HREQ is working very hard to complete the school allocation and transfer process for next school year. We are actually hoping to have the initial teacher transfer list ready to look at next week so that we can begin making those assignment changes, notifications to teachers before they leave for the end of the school year.
Thank you. Ms. Kuhn.
Good morning. This Friday is School Lunch Hero Day, and I just wanted to remind the board of that. It made me think about last year when we had all the families going through with the pictures up in their car windows, and made me reflect on the past year and everything that our schools and employees have done to support our students. So this Friday, happy Lunch Hero Day to our FNS Lunch Heroes.
Thank you. Dr. Moore.
Good morning, board. May the force be with you as we celebrate May 4th. As you are aware, May is full of celebrations. So on behalf of our career, technical, and adult education family, we want to thank our exceptional principals, because Principal Day was May 1st. Of course, our outstanding teachers, our fabulous nurses, because nurses' celebration is coming up, and our lunchroom superheroes. Every day, these individuals create safe and caring spaces for learning for our students, and we just want to say thank you. I also have a few highlights to share with you. The Pasco Young Entrepreneurs Final Competition was held on April 29th. This is an exciting event that allows entrepreneurship students, finalists, to pitch a unique business idea to a panel of business experts. The competition provides aspiring entrepreneurs the opportunity to win up to $1,000 in cash to aid in promoting their idea. Additionally, through networking with CTE business stakeholders, students gain valuable insight into successful business ownership. A special thanks to the Pasco Education Foundation for their continued support and sponsorship in making this unique student experience possible. Judges included representatives from the District Career Advisory Council. So our young entrepreneurs were from the following schools which competed, and the winners are also included in this. So Cypress Creek High School had first place with Nicholas Morgan. He won the $1,000. River Ridge High School had second place with Michael Smith, Madeline Stamper, and Julie Smolsky, and they won $500. Zephyr Hills High School had third place with Amber Leach, Mackenzie Kabali, and they won $250. J.W. Mitchell High School, Land O'Lakes High School, Pasco High School, and Sun Lake High School, and Wiregrass Ranch High School also competed. In the health science world, our certified nursing assistant testing is almost complete for our students, and so far we have 127 students from 6 high schools and Marchman Technical College that have taken their licensing exam. Of the 124 of the 127 students have passed and have become Florida certified nursing assistants, which means they're ready to enter into the workforce upon graduation. We still have 8 more students to test on May 11th, and additionally, 4 high school CNA training programs have achieved a 100% pass rate. These schools are Pasco High School, Zephyr Hills High School, Wiregrass Ranch High School, and J.W. Mitchell High School. Marchman Technical College students have also achieved a 100% pass rate on the exam. And as I said, National Nurses Week begins on Thursday, May 6th, and runs through May 12th. And we will be celebrating that in the Office of Career, Technical, and Adult Education as we recognize our 10 certified nursing assistants, teachers, who work hard educating our next generation of healthcare workers. Also want to let you know that Centennial Middle School Principal, Dr. Rick Saylor, was featured in this month's Florida Department of Education Career and Technical Education newsletter. The article was titled, CTE Continuing to Elevate Centennial Middle School Principal Dance Challenge 2020. So as a STEM leader in Pasco County, Dr. Saylor, and his staff agreed to a middle school dance challenge, which was really interesting. If you'd like the link, I'll send it to you. Yes. But it was a great opportunity, and they did some coding with their coding teacher, and they just excelled. And so they were featured, so we want to congratulate them on that opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Swenson, and board members. I've asked her to pull 12.4, the investment oversight report, into hers. So, Ms. Swenson, it's all yours.
Thank you. I would like to ask Mr. Cristoforo to come up and then introduce the chair of the investment oversight committee.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, board members, superintendent, attorney Alfonso. As is required by the board every year, we report the investment oversight committee. The chairman is here. I would like to introduce him. His name is John Lettman, and he's the current chair. He's been on the committee for over 10 years. So to that end, I'd like to have him come up and do the report. Thank you.
Welcome back, sir.
Yes, thank you so much for being here. It's good to see you.
Thank you for having me, Chairman Altman and school board members, Superintendent Browning, district staff. Yes, it's been an interesting year. I'd like to read the reports in your packet, the Investment Oversight Committee. The committee was created at the request of the school board to serve as an advisory committee. The committee is comprised of five voting members, appointed by each school board member, two non-voting members, chief financial officer, director of finance services, and one board member, Mrs. Armstrong. The responsibility for providing oversight and direction in regard to the management of the investment program resides with the district chief finance officer and the director of finance services. The primary purpose of the committee is to independently review the district's investment portfolio and to determine compliance with the district's investment policies, principal objectives of safety, liquidity, and total return. In addition, the committee reviews the district's investment policy and reports in the school board any changes, additions, deletions to the policy, and also assists the finance services staff in the evaluation of investment consultants, financial advisors, banking services, and the issuance of debt. During the past year, the committee worked very diligently and was able to accomplish the following. We completed 30.6 million refunding of the COPS 2005B with the issuance of a COPS 2020A. This reduced the district's exposure to variable rate debt by locking the interest rate at 1.77% and producing a savings of $340,879 until its maturity on August the 8th of 2030. We then issued the COP Series 2020C and 2020D in a public offering at a par amount of $75.6 million and at a premium amount of $97.3 million. The COPs 2020C was issued at an interest rate of 2.54% for 25 years with proceeds of $72 million that will be used for the construction of Kirkland Ranch Academy of Innovation. The COPS 2020D was issued at an interest rate of 1.33% for 10 years, with proceeds being used to refund the COPS 2014A and generated a $2.3 million savings for the life of the issue. We then completed a $71.5 million refunding of COPS 2008C with the issuance of the COPS 2020B. The refunding was completed in a public offering to replace the expiring floating rate note that was expiring. The COPS 2020B was issued at an interest rate of 4.71% and is fixed for 3 years. We then issued the Capital Improvement Revenue Bonds, Series 2020, to refund a CIRB 2003 and to generate additional funds for capital projects. The CIRB 2020 were issued at a par amount of $3.4 million and a premium amount of $4.0 million for 30 years at an interest rate of 2.89%. The district financed the purchase of 40 diesel buses, 3 maintenance service vehicles, 40 radios for a total of $4.4 million at a rate of 1.99% for a 7-year term. The district financed the purchase of Apple, HP, Dell laptops totaling $2.5 million and iPads totaling $229,791 for 3 to 4 years at rates between 1.89% and 2.02%. For the fiscal year 2019-2020, the district investment program earned a total of $8,473,989. In the interest, net of fees paid to an investment advisor of $23,126. And finally, we completed a request for proposal for investment management advisory services. We selected Water Walker Investments to manage the short-term and core portfolios, and PFM Asset Management to manage the supplemental early retirement program. The accomplishments of the committee would not have been possible without the valuable services of the entire committee. Special thanks, Mr. Alfred Torrance, for his dedicated terms of service as chairman. I would also like to welcome a new member, Mr. Tim Baldwin, retired banker from Dade City. And the accomplishments of the committee would not have been possible without the valuable services of the entire committee.
Thank you, Ms. Armstrong.
Yes, thank you so much. I cannot say enough about the Oversight Committee, how dedicated they are, how they ask the right questions of our financial advisors, how they make sure that our investments follow our school board policy, and make suggestions as to how we could improve the amount of money that we do receive from our investments, how we can save money. They're just invaluable. They're so dedicated to making sure that we are the best stewards of the money in public schools. So thank you so much, and thank you so much for taking the role of chairman. Really look forward to the next meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lutman. Ms. Swenson.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Levin. He is retiring. This is his last time in the committee.
Oh, no. All right. We're going to miss you.
He decided he had enough.
I can't imagine why.
Thank you. Thank you for your service. I do have
a couple more items.
Fitch Ratings just released our ratings, which is AA, and for our COPS and sales taxes, an A+. If you remember last year, all school districts were put in a negative outlook because of the pandemic. However, ours moved up to stable, so we're doing fine. And finally, I'd like to report that there are some changes in the finance department. Mr. Dominic Cristofaro will become the treasurer, and he will be basically in charge of what you just heard, all those items, investment oversight, the cash management, and issuing debt. Dominic has been with us for 8 years, and he has 27 years of investment management experience. With that, Michelle Williams will become the interim director. As you know, Michelle has been in the service, the district, for over 30 years. She grew up in Pasco County and has been a teacher, assistant principal, and principal. The last 3 years, she has been with finance as a senior manager, and we feel that her leadership skills will provide guidance to the department until a new director and a new CFO is hired for my replacement. But the biggest report that Michelle wanted me to share was that she just became a grandma. So, yay, for a baby. I would like to invite Michelle because she's got to share some additional promotions in the finance department. Michelle?
Did she not tell you she was going to put you on the spot?
She knows me well. But
welcome to being a director.
So, yes. Well, thank you, Chair, Vice Chairman Armstrong, Superintendent, Mr. Alfonso, all of you. I want to welcome and announce our two new senior managers in finance, Janie Hare and Casey Canute. I'm going to ask them both to stand. So, yes, you can. These two have are also Pasco County students, former students, and have been in the finance department, I think it's seven years. I think Casey started as a BCE student, as a temp, and have worked in both the accounting area, property control, capital. A lot of you have worked with Casey with capital. Janie has been working with budget, all of the bookkeeping in the schools, and also grants in the last couple of years. But I want to congratulate both of them on their new promotions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And my last item is I'm in the process of reviewing the budget, and I will have a report to you in the next board meeting.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Hilton.
Good morning. I don't have millions of dollars of investments to share with you, but I do have millions of world-class learning moments because of the commitment of our Pasco teachers and leaders. So I'll just share a few things with you today. Prior to last March, our district was chosen to participate in a continuous improvement process with an organization called SHIFT through a project titled IM4E, meaning I am for equity. We were provided this opportunity through our relationship with the Gates Foundation, and the process has included a deep look at a focused project, which for Pasco was aimed at the work we've been doing to include more and more students in our advanced coursework in middle school. Our team focused specifically on one school and a process called Second Look, and as a result, we have at that school included more students in sixth grade advanced math, which we have shared many times is crucial to later success in mathematics and the mathematics pathway. As a result of our work, our member of our team, Ms. Tanya Shook, in the Office for Leading and Learning, was asked to present as part of a panel at the National Carnegie Foundation Summit. That was last week. She, of course, did an amazing job, and we are so proud of her, as well as this work, to ensure more equitable opportunities for our students as we scale this among our middle schools. So that is a great success. Just a reminder, too, as Ms. Armstrong already shared, May is Mental Health Awareness Month. I shared lots of information with you last time. Thank you to Ms. Armstrong for sharing some of the impactful work of our mental health team and efforts to support mental health by our student services team members. This week, I hope you've noticed that our amazing students are engaged in hashtag Pasco Students Speak. You can check Twitter to hear the incredible voices of our students as they share their heart and passion around contributing to a better society. You can hear and see them present on topics like bullying prevention, saving honeybees, protecting sea turtles, the important role of foster care, the dangers of smoking, stopping water pollution, the importance of national parks, and how simple acts of kindness can change the world. It is your support of events like these that gives us a chance to see the talent and potential of our Pasco students. They are truly world class, and so are the teachers who support them every day. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Hexler-Nettles.
Good morning. I would also like to just wish a very happy Teacher Appreciation Week to all of our teachers and express my gratitude for all the hard work and dedication that they put in. It's been very exciting to see the numerous community and school leaders, sponsors, businesses, partnerships, PTAs, parent organizations, you name it, all across the county. They have really stepped up to ensure our educators have been treated in special and unique ways all across the county. So thank you to those groups. Ms. Hilton did a great job reading you lots of specific titles, but I also wanted to mention to please take a look at the social media this week. The topic of contributing to a better society has led to some really incredible work from our students, and it's really exciting to see their inspiring messages. And then finally, I just would like to thank you for your support at the numerous turnaround student events last week. They were very intimate, and the students appreciated that small setting, and we appreciate your support and recognition of their hard work and success.
Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Poe.
Yes, good morning. Just to continue the celebrations, I won't go into any specifics, but I truly believe Pasco has the best of the best, and that goes from our administrators to our teachers to our support staff in whatever capacity they serve. We really are in the best district. I want to share a specific celebration from Longleaf Elementary School. You know, they are a Florida Arts Model School, and arts truly come to life throughout their campus. I'm sure you remember pre-COVID all the wonderful performances that come from that school. This year, of course, they're doing things a little differently, but a fourth grade class, it's Miss Sadlin's class, wrote a play, and they submitted it to the Florida Studio Theater's Young Playwrights Festival,
and they were selected as a winner. What that means is their play was acted out on stage by professional actors, and you're able to now view their play virtually. So I wanted to share that with you, and I'll be sure to send that link. Their play is titled The Sloth Who Became Queen. So be on the lookout for that. We want to celebrate the efforts there in a very different year to continue to keep the arts alive and well at Longleaf Elementary.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Isles.
I would like to celebrate and recognize two of Pasco County students who received the 2021 Sunshine Opportunity Scholarships. These students will receive $20,000 over a four-year time period to attend a Florida university. This scholarship is given to high-achieving seniors who have overcome significant obstacles. We had two winners in Pasco County, Alexis Fernandez from Land O'Lakes High School and Nicholas Thod Horry from Gulf High School. So quite a celebration point. Additionally, as mentioned by Mrs. Hetzler-Nettles, last week I was able to participate in two turnaround awards. These students impacted me with the importance of having a goal and a pathway in seeing success. The first student was Nicole at 5A High School, and definitely on the information I was given, she had brought her GPA up and was on her way to graduating. I think the significant impact for her when I met her is that she was planning on getting a bachelor's degree in psychology. But even more so, what impressed me is that she did not share it, but her dad did. She actually works full-time as an assistant manager, and she often doesn't get home until 3 a.m. in the morning. So she is doing everything in school, plus that, and she is on her way to graduating and will be attending community college right after she graduates. Additionally, second student, Taylor at Hudson High School, amazing individual, and really got behind in studies because her mom got brain cancer, and ultimately her family came first. So she ultimately, because of that, wants to be a nurse, and really proud of her. So I have one more thing to do. Obviously, I should never talk about things where it's emotional, right? I'd like to end my words today by recognizing Mike Cloyd for his dedication and leadership. He will be retiring after 32 years in education. His last day is this Friday, May 7th. He began his career in law, and after practicing for 5 years, realized he wanted to make more of an impact. He decided on teaching and served 10 years in Chicago's struggling schools as an ELA teacher. He later moved to Hillsborough County, and then for the past 13 years has been in Pasco County. He began in Pasco as an ELA supervisor serving 6th through 12th graders. Serving as a principal at that time, I appreciated Mike's ability to simplify paperwork and to strategically focus on good instructional practices. His expertise helped me with curriculum alignment and best practices. He never failed to show up to a teacher meeting or to meet with me in the evening due to my schedule. He later pursued administration. As a principal, he has had a true lasting impact on his students. I have been on his campus and witnessed students returning just to thank him for his support, and it happens a lot. Additionally, on social media throughout the pandemic, I would watch as Mike would have to post some not favorable news. His students were quick to thank him for what he was doing. He also had more student design pictures than any other principal I know. This includes a picture of him on a gator for the famous Butterball Bowl, and a picture of him as a wizard, obviously an indication of his wise advice. Those are just a few. He has also been an advocate for teachers and staff, respecting their professionalism and supporting them with their endeavors. His leadership has been valuable. I want to thank him for his leadership, and while Sun Lake High School will be in good hands, Mike Cloyd's efforts will continue to be appreciated long after he retires.
Thank you.
Dr. Isles, if I remember those scholarships, there were 10 statewide? Was it 10 or 12?
It was a small number. I think it was 12. 12. I'm going from memory.
And two of them out of Pasco County.
Yes.
Very significant. Dr. Skanga?
Today, sir.
Really?
Yeah.
Man. Okay. Well, we have no expulsion recommendations either, so we'll move to the consent agenda. Board members, is there anything anybody wants to pull? If not, I'll entertain a motion for the consent agenda along with the addendum from 10.1 that was provided to us beforehand.
So moved.
Second.
Motion Crumley, second Armstrong. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you. So we go to action items 15.1, the instructional materials for CTE. I'll entertain a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Bodwin, second by Harding. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
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 Motion passes. 15.2, adoption of instructional materials for elementary 6, 8, 9, 10 ELA.
So moved.
Second.
Motion Harding, second Crumley. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye. Aye.
Motion passes. 15.3, emergency action modifying the student progression plan.
So moved.
Second.
Motion Harding, second by Armstrong. Any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. 15.4, proclamation. Board Member Bodwin is going to read that for us.
Thank you. And I'd like to recognize Bryce and David and Adriana and John and Nate and Grace and Bay and Preston and all the students who have Tourette syndrome. I also want to note that none of these kids are defined by their TS. They are gifted in math and history and music, and they inspire me every day. So, whereas Tourette syndrome is a neurodevelopmental disorder with symptoms that include involuntary, repetitive movements and sounds called tics, which can wax and wane and can change unpredictably. And whereas Tourette syndrome and other tic disorders are not rare, the current estimates are that one out of every 160 children between the ages of 5 and 17 in the United States has Tourette syndrome. And whereas Tourette syndrome commonly co-occurs with a number of other neurodevelopmental and neuropsychiatric conditions, the most common of which is attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder, obsessive compulsive disorder, processing problems, behavior challenges, anxiety, social skill deficits, handwriting difficulties, learning difficulties, and sleep problems. The characteristics of these conditions are often more problematic and harder to manage than the tics. Now, therefore, the District School Board of Pasco County does hereby declare May 15th, 2021 through June 15th, 2021 as Tourette Syndrome Awareness Month. So I move to approve.
Second.
Well, motion by Bodwin, second by Harding. Any discussion? All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. 15.5, I'll take a motion for us to be able to entertain an off-agenda item.
I move to accept the off-agenda item.
And second that.
A motion by Bodwin, second by Crumley to take an off-agenda item. All in favor?
Aye.
15.5, First Amendment to SRO agreement. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Bodwin, second by Armstrong. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion passes. Thank you. Individual board member reports. We'll go the other direction. Ms. Armstrong.
All right. I did have a chance to go on Zoom and attend the Young Entrepreneur Competition. And I have to say, what an amazing job they did putting on the event. I've attended it in person as well as by Zoom now. And it was just seamless the way they did it. The questions were judges could ask the same questions they normally would ask and give the advice that it really worked out well. And I just wanted to comment on one of the winners, the second place winners from River Ridge High School. Their name of their project was Kids Invest. That was really something that came about from one of the students at River Ridge Middle School that was riding their bike to school and was killed by being hit by a car. So they came up with the plan to make these vests that are lighted that would be suitable for all age groups, target market really more towards elementary probably. I will say that group had actually reached out to myself and probably other board members to talk about how best to promote their product. This was months ago. So this is something I know they've been working on for a long time and it meant a lot to them. So they were second place and got the $500 award. So I really expect to see that PTAs are probably going to hear from them about their product because they seemed very determined to make this product work for safety of our students. So I just want to say the whole idea of more entrepreneurship in all our schools is just amazing. I asked my husband, is this something you would have done when you were in high school? And he said, you bet I would have, because that he is the typical entrepreneur. So I'm so glad we're addressing that need of our students that want to own their own business, come up with their own ideas. I also attended Turnaround Student Awards at Enclote High School and Paul R. Smith Middle School. It was a more intimate situation, but it did give you a chance to talk to the parents, and the parents were so supportive. One parent I was so impressed with, he said, I was the opposite of a turnaround student, always getting in trouble, not making the grades, and I want to make sure that my son has all the opportunities that I did not have because of what I did in high school. And so his son is doing him proud, and you could just tell how proud and supportive he was of his son. And then also teacher appreciation. Can't say enough about what our teachers have done this year in making sure that our students receive the best education. They've overcome obstacles. They didn't let obstacles stop them. They've came up with inventive ways to reach the students. I'm just so thankful that we have the teachers that we have in this district, and so appreciative of everything that they've done this year.
Thank you, Ms. Bodwin.
Thank you. I attended some turnaround ceremonies as well at Rushi Middle School. Vanessa Perez was recognized at Wiregrass Ranch High School, Malcolm Calhoun, and at Land O'Lakes High School, Trevor Dalpe. I want to congratulate them and all the turnaround students who were recognized, and thank the teachers and staff who support them. I attended the Teacher Leadership Academy final project presentations. They were about being change agents, so they were change projects. Some of them were included addressing school culture with teachers supporting teachers. They had clubs for teachers and staff at New River. One of the projects was around intervention periods at Cypress Creek Middle and High School, and they looked at the most productive way to use intervention periods for remediation. There was another one on culture and climate where they had a safe space for staff to feel visible and heard during COVID, and all of this was to foster a collaborative culture. They put us into groups, so I didn't get to see all of them, but those were some of the ones they saw, and was very impressed by the teachers and grateful for them putting all this time in to make a positive impact in their schools. I also attended the Newspaper and Education Teacher of the Year Awards, where Brenda Curtwright of Enclote High School was honored, and this is the second time she's been honored since I've been on the board. So I want to congratulate Dr. Curtwright and thank the St. Pete Times, Suncoast Credit Union, and McDonald's Casper Company for supporting our teachers and students with that program. And I was able to, one of those other events was the same time as the Young Entrepreneurs event, but I did get to get and see part of the competition. I came in a little bit late, but I did get to see a couple of the presentations, and the ones I saw were very impressive. So thank you for that program as well. That's it.
Ms. Cromley?
Yeah, I don't have a particular report. I just wanted to express my appreciation for our amazing teachers, especially during this past year, during this teacher appreciation event. I really don't even have enough words to express it, but that's really all I had to say.
Thank you. Ms. Harding?
I got to spend some time in the NTA, the New Teacher Academy, helping the students create really engaging lesson plans. Those students are just, they're absolutely amazing every time I go visit, and I'm just know they're going to be wonderful educators one day, and we're going to be very blessed when we get to hire them in Pasco. I also got to attend an FSBA training on finance. I always just learn so much when I go, and I'm very grateful that even as a board member that I have the opportunity to continue to learn and grow. I also got to spend some time at Fox Hall Elementary School last Friday. I spent time in the first grade pod in Mrs. Hinson's class. They had just finished a social studies unit, and they had a virtual field trip day to Disney World. And it was such a well-thought-out, engaging, fun day for our students, and I just love that I was able to be a part of it. Also, like mentioned previously, last week was National Principals Day, and I just wanted to thank and give a shout-out to all our amazing principals and thank them for their dedication to our students, especially during this very eventful year. I also got to go to some turnaround student events at Hudson Middle School with Casey. I'm just so proud of all he's accomplished. It was a very emotional ceremony, and like was mentioned, very intimate. He got emotional, and then his teacher got emotional, and it was just so wonderful just to see students turning around. I also got to visit Hudson High School, as Dr. Isles had mentioned, Taylor Guzman. Hers too was so emotional, and I'm just so proud of all the things that she's overcome, and I can't wait to see all the wonderful things that she does. And finally, as mentioned, this week is Teacher and Staff Appreciation Week, and I just wanted to thank our amazing teachers and staff who go above and beyond each day with our students for their dedication and persevering through this very tough and different school year, and I'm so grateful for each and every one of them, and I just wanted to say thank you.
Thank you. I attended 5 turnaround presentations. The one unique thing was that according to Ramon, they believe at this point we had the first brother and sister winners in the same year. The sister was a student at Zephyr Hills High School, the brother at Raymond Stewart Middle School, both of them winners. And also attended the senior award celebration at Pasco High School. And then the other day I made a visit to the Kirkland Academy that is coming along just amazingly well. I talked to Josh Baumstein and the architect, and things are going well. We are dealing with, as everybody in the construction industry is, struggling trying to get materials sometime, but they have overcome that so far and are on schedule, and it looks magnificent so far.
We need pictures.
Yeah.
So, well, right now it's steel and road. In the next couple of 3 weeks, it will look completely different, and we'll get some photographs. Maybe, Mr. Gadd, if you can ask staff when they're out there.
Andy's going to take care of it.
Oh, well, that'll be even better, because Andy's the photo tog, so yeah. We'll be good on that. All right, that's it. Mr. Alfonso.
Yes, Mr. Chair, I just wanted to say a few remarks. I spoke briefly with the superintendent, probably about 17 times last night, as we were trying to figure out what to do with all of the executive orders that had been coming out from the governor's office. I wanted to report to the board. I tried to share with you as much information as I could real time last night as we were getting this information. For the benefit of the public, I'm certain there's a lot of media coverage about what these orders that they're out, and there are a lot of discussions about what they mean. But that's what I want to focus on to the board right now. I know late last night and early this morning we received some guidance from the Florida Department of Education. The commissioner put out a statement basically, or at least a directive guidance, saying that those executive orders that were issued by the governor do not apply to school districts. So whatever occurs with regard to those, we could spend hours thinking about them and talking about them. There's a lot of smarter lawyers in the world than me that are doing that right now, because they have impact on all municipalities, local governments, with a lot of different context on how people adopted things. But they don't apply to school districts.
Yes, they do.
This school...
Yes, they do.
So this school district, and I don't want to engage or respond to this, because the reality is the school district adopted its policy. It's probably worth it just to cover this so we put it all in perspective. So the school district initially reacted in June 23rd of 2020 when Pasco County, the county, issued an executive order kind of like what's being regulated by these governor orders right now, saying no mandates. Thereafter, the school board followed suit in that it followed to say we're going to issue this mask mandate by emergency action, emergency rulemaking. After the emergency rulemaking occurred, that only lasts for 90 days by law. So this board then adopted its current policy, which is 8450.01, that talks about the authority to mandate face coverings. It is not dependent upon any action taken by the governor specifically.
So you're above them? I would like to know why you two...
Officer, would you remove her, please?
So,
ma'am, that's the end of comments. You can leave.
Thank you. So,
thank you.
Board members, so the point of all this is just to react to the most important information right now. This emergency perception of last night's executive orders really has no immediate impact on the board. Where the board is right now is you have a policy that was properly adopted and that actually runs through until the end of the 2020-2021 school year, unless there is some compelling reason issued by the superintendent to modify that. Nothing is before the board for action today, period. So the board could not act properly to modify, repeal, or change its existing policy. That's kind of the short and sweet of where we are, and I'm happy to answer questions if anyone has any.
Yes,